Cool. Well, we're in Daniel chapter 3. If you have a Bible, turn to Daniel chapter 3. Michael will bring you a Bible if you don't have one. Just raise your hand. He's got them ready right there. You're going to need one tonight. We're going to read a lot. Bible, get your Bibles. We'll do Daniel chapter 3 and 4 tonight. And we're kind of going to do an overview to get through the book of Daniel relatively quickly. There's 12 chapters. We've gone through two so far. Gone through two chapters in I don't know how many weeks. But we're going to get through it because the middle of February we're starting growth groups up again, which are awesome. Smaller groups meeting at different people's homes and discussing whether it's the sermon from Sunday or a different topic altogether. They're a great way for the church to get connected and kind of a good break from just a teaching, you know, sermon atmosphere, which we have on Sunday, of course. So that's going to start up middle of February, so we're going to have 5 more weeks of Daniel. So we're going to do a little bit of an overview. We're still going to read it, but we're not going to go as in-depth as we normally do, God willing. All right, so let's pray one more time. I'm going to pray for the time of teaching so that we can understand what we read. Lord, we do come to you again believing that you are and that you are a rewarder of those who diligently seek you. So tonight we seek you and we ask that you would teach us. I pray that as we leave this place tonight, we would feel enriched and encouraged, built up in the faith, and that each of us would have a personal application for ourselves from tonight's message. And that all of us would be able to understand your message through the book of Daniel and through the life of Daniel and even the life of Nebuchadnezzar the king as we study these two chapters tonight. We look to you for your guidance, Holy Spirit. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. The fiery furnace and Nebuchadnezzar's fall. So by a show of hands, who here has heard of the fiery furnace with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? All right, good. Most of you. Even if you haven't, you just have to raise your hands anyway because everybody else is. But this is a very famous story. Even non-Christians are familiar with this story. But it's a great story, and that's the story that we're going to look at in Daniel chapter 3. And then Daniel chapter 4 is the story of King Nebuchadnezzar and the way that God humbled him. So let's get right into it, starting in chapter 3, verse 1. I'm going to read from verse 1 to verse 7. We're going to take this in sections. Most of it is narrative, meaning it's a story, so we're going to read as the story unfolds. We're going to discuss each section and make a couple points of application, then move on to the next, okay? So Nebuchadnezzar, King Nebuchadnezzar made an image of gold whose height was 60 cubits, its breadth 6 cubits. Your Bible may have the, what's it called, a translation or a... Conversion, that's the exact word I was looking for. Conversion, which is 90 feet by 9 feet. So here's a statue that was 90 feet tall, 9 feet wide. He set it up on the plain of Dura in the province of Babylon. Then King Nebuchadnezzar sent to gather the satraps, the prefects, the governors, the counselors, the treasurers, the justices, the magistrates, and all the officials of the province to come to the dedication of the image that King Nebuchadnezzar had set up. Then the satraps, the prefects, the governors, the counselors, the treasurers, the justices, the magistrates, and all the officials of the provinces gathered for the dedication of the image that King Nebuchadnezzar had set up. And they stood before the image that Nebuchadnezzar had set up. And the herald proclaimed aloud, "You are commanded, O peoples, nations, and languages, that when you hear the sound of the horn, the pipe, the lyre, the trigon, the harp, the bagpipe." So there was some Scottish people there. Boom. That's proof. "And every kind of music, you are to fall down and worship the golden image that King Nebuchadnezzar has set up. And whoever does not fall down and worship shall immediately be cast into a burning fiery furnace." So this is like a day of celebration. Look at this wonderful statue. When you hear the music, bow down. If you don't bow down, we're going to throw you into the fiery furnace. So, verse 7, "As soon as all the people heard the sound of the horn, the pipe, the lyre, the trigon, the harp, the bagpipe, and every kind of music, All the people, nation, and languages fell down and worshiped the golden image that King Nebuchadnezzar had set up. So here in our first section, the command to worship this image. And it was most likely in the kind of the shape of a man, but as you can see from the dimensions, it was tall and narrow, like an obelisk, with probably the king's, you know, image, or it could have been, I read some descriptions where it could have been like a tall pedestal made of gold with a statue at the top of it, you know, 90 feet high, 9 feet wide. But it was made of gold, whether it was coated in gold or solid gold, we don't know, but it was an image that King Nebuchadnezzar made people worship. You guys remember chapter 2? It was a while back, but Nebuchadnezzar had a dream. This is the king. By the way, if you're not familiar with Nebuchadnezzar, he was basically the king of the world, like Leonardo DiCaprio. He was the king of the world, but he really was the king of the world. And Babylon was the most powerful empire at the time, and so he had a dream in chapter 2 that God gave him. The dream was of a statue that's head was gold, and then it went down and made of different metals representing different kingdoms. That was what chapter 2 was about. So Nebuchadnezzar, this is years later, actually. Chapter 3 is years later, about 16 years later. So he, at this point, he has built this statue, and he didn't build it like the dream. He built it all one metal, gold. Why? Because he was saying, I basically don't care what the dream was like or what God has told me about these different nations and what's going to happen. My kingdom is going to rule forever, and I'm the most powerful man in the world. And to prove that, everybody in the world is going to come and bow down. And so he was basically setting up this image for the people to worship. So the command to worship, three things just really briefly before we move on to verse 8. And this says something about our own worship, because everybody worships something. You guys believe that? Everybody worships something. They live for something, whether themselves or a relationship or money or greed or power or God. Everybody worships something. And in this worship of this idol, we can get some insight into the way that people worship and actually into the way that we worship God. So number one, there were people that were worshiping. Who were they? Verses 1 to 3 describes the leaders of the community. There were military leaders, all these different magistrates, treasurers, justices. There were basically leaders in civic society. There were military leaders. There were judicial leaders. There were bankers. All of these people that basically ran the whole world were the leaders of the people. And the people that were worshiping were led there by the leaders who were worshiping. So in modern day terminology, the politicians, the leaders of government, the leaders of society, the cultural leaders are influencing. When you can get the leaders to worship, then the people will worship. And that's what Nebuchadnezzar did. He said all the leaders come and worship, and therefore all the people under them are going to follow suit. And that's why it's important for us as leaders, just a little application, to be worshipers, because when we worship, then people worship that we're entrusted to lead. But also something else about the worship, not only the people, but the music. In verses 4 and 5, and you read all the instruments. There were 6 there. And then any other ones that were mentioned, all the other kind of instruments. So basically Nebuchadnezzar knew something else, not only to bring the leaders into worship, but also to use music for worship. And this is extremely important. Why? Because God created music special. I don't know how else to say it. Like, music is a special thing. There's an emotional and I would say even a spiritual connection that human beings have when they listen to music, whether for good or for bad. You guys agree with that? It's something that kind of stirs up the senses and the emotions. And when you look in the Bible at God's worship services, whether it's in the tabernacle or the temple or the church, he always talks about using music to praise his name, because God has designed us to respond emotionally and spiritually to music. On the negative side, music can also be used by the devil to promote the emotion to engage with those negative parts of our culture and our society. So music is of the devil. No, it's not. It's of God. But as with any good thing that God gives us, the devil perverts it and makes it used for improper purposes. As a matter of fact, it's interesting when the devil is described in the book of Ezekiel, he is described as having like musical instruments as part of his description. Did you guys know that? We're not going to get into it because we don't have time, but he was actually the worship leader in heaven. The devil was not always bad. I don't know if you guys knew that. He is a fallen angel.
So you look at Michael J.
Yeah, so picture Michael. So the devil was the chief angel. He's a created being, an angel, responsible for giving worship to God. And worship to God, God has always designed it to be musical, because music has a connection with the soul. And so when he fell, he then fell with that talent and that gift to be able to use music, except now it's perverted against God. I was just looking at the top 50 songs, like Billboard Top 50 or whatever. Or I got Spotify and I can see the top 50 hits. Probably 70 to 80% of them are explicit songs that are full of like some pretty raunchy stuff. But when you listen to the songs, they got good beats, right? And there's like, there's a way that they connect. And you kind of look at it and you say, this is really, it's almost sad because the devil has perverted music and made it, in many cases, better than Christian music. Although Christian music, I think, is coming up in different ways and stuff like that. But anyway, that's a little bit outside of my realm of expertise. When you're talking about music, you can talk to Michael more about that. But the point of this being that music was used in the worship of this false god. And in our case, music is used to emotionally connect us in the worship of our God. And that's a good thing. Longfellow, Henry Wadsworth Longfellow. Music is the universal language of mankind, he said. Think about it. Some people say mathematics is the language of mankind, universal language. But the reality is, yeah, who knows about, you know, who knows, like, you know, how are we going to... I'm illiterate, if that's the case. But when you talk about music, go to any country, any culture, across the world, across the globe, and you're going to find musical expression, right? And that's kind of the point. God has given us that. Marilyn Manson said, music is the strongest form of magic. You know who Marilyn Manson is? That's back in my day, back in the 90s. You know? All right. All right, good. So, and he got it. I mean, his music was not necessarily edifying or uplifting. it has some good beats and stuff, like I said. But he got it right when he said, this is a magical thing. It's something that even non-Christians recognize can connect with people's hearts and souls. So let's make sure that we're using music, for the most part, to connect with God and help us in worship. And that's why worship ministry is so important in churches. It's not just a filler for, you know, the real deal, which is the message, but it's how we worship. The Psalms is a whole book. Largest book in the Bible is given to worship. And Psalms like Psalm 150 talk about praising the God with trumpets and harps and tambourines and drums and the stringed instruments and cymbals and clashing cymbals, that these musical instruments are supposed to be used to worship God. Okay, move on. The motivation for worship. So we have the people there, the leaders, the music is being played. So what was the ultimate motivation for these people to worship the idol, Nebuchadnezzar's statue? It was fear, wasn't it? Worship, or we're going to throw you into the fiery furnace. Now, when you think about the worship of God, what is our motivation for worshiping God? It's love. Some people think that it should be fear to motivate people to worship God. You better worship God or else he's going to throw you into hell. And then you're like, okay, I'll worship God. But that doesn't really incite a true feeling of worship, does it? It's kind of a negative feeling. Even though hell is real and judgment is real, that is not the motivation for why we follow God and serve God. We follow God and serve God and worship God because of a motivation of love. 1 John chapter 4, verse 17, by this love is perfected with us, so that we may have confidence on the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we also in this world. Listen to this. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. For fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not been perfected in love. Now, verse 19 of 1 John 4, we love because he first loved us. What is our motivation for loving and lovingly worshiping? It is the love that we've received from God first. Not the judgment or the fear of judgment. Perfect love casts that out. Now we worship God because we love him. And that's the exact opposite of worshiping any other thing. Moving on to verse 8. Therefore at the time, certain Chaldeans came forward and maliciously accused the Jews. They declared to King Nebuchadnezzar, O king, live forever. So flattery. Flattery will get you everywhere. You, king, have made a decree that every man who hears the sound of the horn, pipe, lyre, okay, we know all the instruments, should fall down and worship the golden image. Verse 11, whoever does not fall down and worship shall be cast into the burning fiery furnace. There are certain Jews whom you have appointed over the affairs of the province of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These men, O king, pay no attention to you. They do not serve your gods or worship the golden image that you have set up. Then Nebuchadnezzar, in furious rage, commanded that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego be brought. So they brought these men before the king. Nebuchadnezzar answered and said to them, is it true, O Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you do not serve my gods or worship the golden image that I set up? Now if you are ready, when you hear the sound of these instruments, you fall down and worship the image that I have made, you do it well and good. But if you do not worship, you shall immediately be cast into a burning fiery furnace. And who is the God who will be able to deliver you out of my hands? Can you just imagine the scene for a second? This is the most powerful man in the world. Like, think of a powerful man in our world today. It's nothing compared to this. This guy had complete and total power over all the nations of the world, all the known world at the time. And he himself is talking to you. So you can imagine everybody, all the leaders, all the important, powerful people bowing down. The music is playing. And here's the three guys that are not bowing down when the music is playing. Some people have asked, where is Daniel during all this? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, where is Daniel? And as I was studying about it, many people say, basically they don't know. Probably on a diplomatic mission or something. What we do know is Daniel's character, that he was very unlikely that Daniel was bowing down, right? Because you look at, I mean, he was being willing to get cast into the lion's den and be, you know, punished from the king for not eating certain things. So he no doubt was of the same mind, but it points out these three guys. So they had a contradiction of conscience. They were told to bow down and worship the image, and they knew that they should only worship God. That's what the Bible says. The Lord is your God, and you shall worship the Lord, and him only shall you serve. That's what the Bible says. So don't worship any other thing. And so what happens is they start to be accused. It says that the Chaldeans accused them in verse 8. Isn't it true today that we as Christians are accused by the world of not basically falling in line and doing what the rest of the world does? If we have our own convictions, if we have our own conscience, if we have our own morals, we are accused by the world of being bigots and hateful and all these other things, just because we have certain convictions and beliefs that we hold. And, you know, I know there are some bigoted Christians and there's some pretty hateful people that are Christians out there. And that's unacceptable as well. That's not who Jesus was. But Jesus, he was accused as well. He was accused of being a glutton and a drunkard. He was accused of being a blasphemer. He was accused of all kinds of things, not serving the Roman government, everything. And so they were accused. And you can expect, when you stand up for what's right and have conviction, which I hope that you have, strong conviction, you might be accused of being, for lack of a better word, evil, of being wrong in this cultural day and age. No matter how good of a person you are and how kind you are and how loving you are, if you have a conviction that goes against what the world says you should have, you will be accused. But not only were they accused, they were also threatened. And this is where it kind of got serious. So there were accusations because of their conscience, but there were also threats. The king said, bow down or else you're going in the fire, and no one will be able to deliver you. And we may be threatened ourselves one day. United States, we don't get threatened that much. We can have freedom of religion and worship. But there are places in the world where it's real. They get threatened for being Christians. There's a great quote from Martin Luther. Not Martin Luther King Jr. He's got some good ones too, but the original Martin Luther way back in the day, the Reformation, where he stood against the powers of his day, which happened to be the Roman Catholic Church. And they called him to a place to answer for his crimes. His crimes were questioning the Pope and the Church, because he said you shouldn't have to pay to get your way out of hell and, you know, a bunch of other things. They said, confess, and then you will be forgiven or whatever. And his quote was, I cannot and will not recant anything, for to go against conscience is neither right nor safe. Here I stand, I can do no other, so help me God, amen. It's basically like, sorry, I can't, it's not safe or right to go against conscience. And I appreciate that about him and about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and about Daniel. And you can even appreciate that when people have convictions that they stand for, even if they're maybe a little like misguided about it, you can respect the conviction. Like, did any of you guys see that movie Hacksaw Ridge? Guys, don't. It's pretty violent. Don't. I'm sorry. It was a true story though, and I saw it, and it was good, because it was a true story about what? He told me no. She didn't see it. I saw it. Andrew told me not. I shouldn't have seen it. It's rated R. So she told me I shouldn't see it, but I saw it and I liked it. But I was impressed by it because it was a true story of a guy in. World War II. Yeah, I know a lot about it, huh? And they were on this island in the South Pacific in World War II, and basically this guy was a pacifist, meaning he wouldn't even touch a gun. And some of you are like, boo, go guns, down with this guy. And that's what they did actually in the movie too. They were like, what's wrong with you? Why don't you do this? And he was basically, it was because of his religious conviction. He was a Seventh-day Adventist, and he was a pacifist. So I look at that and I think, you know, I don't necessarily have that conviction, but he did. And it was a true story. He basically said, I want to be a medic. He didn't want to avoid the war. He wanted to serve his country. So he was a medic and he didn't have a gun in combat. So everybody's getting shot and it's really bloody and violent. So don't see it. But basically, it's a great story. I'm not going to spoil the end or anything, but I know you want to watch it sometime.
But we're not supposed to watch.
You're not. You can watch it if you want to. Well, Andrew said you shouldn't watch it, but he's going to watch it. But it was just awesome to see, like, man, this guy seriously stood for his convictions, like hardcore, and it kind of touched me a little bit when I watched it, and I thought, man, if that guy can do that, then I can stand up for what I believe in, my convictions. And I was thinking about that when I was thinking about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Like, how easy would it, they could have just been, oh, God will forgive me, let me just bow down a little bit. You know, all it would have taken was to get down and just bow down. Anybody can do it. It's easy. It's not like they didn't have to do like a CrossFit training camp or anything, but they just had to bow down. And all they could have rationalized, I just have to do this once. I don't really mean it in my heart, blah, 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 whatever. They said no, and that this was before the most powerful man in the world, because it was a contradiction of their conscience. And Acts chapter 5, verse 29, Peter and the other apostles had the same dilemma, and they said, we must obey God rather than men. That's it. We must obey God rather than men. Whatever God has put in your conscience to do, you stand for that. You do that. Don't compromise. And that's the point. Verse 16, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to answer you in this matter. So basically, You don't have to wait around. We'll give you an. We'll tell you what's going to happen right now. Verse 17. If this be so, meaning I'm going to get thrown into the fire, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace. And he will deliver us out of your hand, O king. But if not, be it known to you, O king, that we will not serve your gods or worship the golden image that you have set up. That's the best part of the whole chapter right there. You know what I love about that is these were men of faith. In fact, in Hebrews chapter 11, it says of the men of faith, it lists this particular occurrence of being thrown into the fire. It lists stopping the mouths of lions. That's Daniel later on. These were men of faith, but look at their faith. What was their faith? So a lot of people say faith is just believing that something is or isn't going to happen just really, really hard, and then it won't happen. So what did they say, though? They said, we know our God is able to deliver us from this fiery furnace. They believed that God, by his power, could protect them from the fire, and they would not get hurt, and they would be delivered from that fire. But then they said, verse 18, if he doesn't, we still are not going to bow down and worship this image. Do you know what that says about faith? Faith is more than just thinking positive about something or believing that something's going to happen or not going to happen. Faith is trusting not only in the power of God, but also in the will of God. That's important about faith, because you'll see a lot of people talk about faith like, if you just believe it, it's going to happen for you. No, faith is more than just kind of your selfish belief power to make things happen. Faith is an active trust in the power and ability of God, but also in the will of God. So God can save me from this fire, or God can deliver me from this financial crisis, or God can help me with this sickness, get over it. But if he doesn't, I still trust in him because he's still God. I trust in the sovereignty of God. And that's a big part of faith. In fact, faith is most genuine and most clearly seen when God doesn't do the things that you want him to do, right? Because then you really have to trust in him. You really have to depend on him. And that's what they're saying. They're saying, he can deliver us, no problem for him. They're answering, because Nebuchadnezzar says, no one can deliver you. They said, yes, he can. But even if he doesn't, we are not going to worship. That's the way a lot of people are. I will serve God and worship God if he does this for me. And these guys are showing true faith, which says, I will serve God and worship God even if he does nothing for me. That's the difference. And that's a big part of what faith really is. Okay, standing firm in the faith. There's a couple of verses, but let's move on. Verse 19. So Nebuchadnezzar was filled with fury, and the expression of his face was changed against Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. So he was trying to be nice. Give them the benefit of the doubt. Okay, maybe you guys didn't hear it. All you got to do, you know, when the band plays, you just bow down and worship, and we'll forget this ever happened. They said, no way. And so his expression on his face changed. So he got TO'd against them. And he ordered the furnace heated 7 times more than it was usually heated. He ordered some of the mighty men of his army to bind Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and to cast them into the burning fiery furnace. Then these men were bound in their cloaks, their tunics, their hats, and their other garments. So they were dressed up and ready for the party. And they threw them into, they were thrown into the burning fiery furnace. Verse 22, because the king's order was urgent and the furnace overheated, the flame of the fire killed the men who took up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And these three men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, fell bound into the fiery furnace. Then King Nebuchadnezzar was astonished and rose up in haste. He declared to his counselors, did we not cast 3 men bound into the fire? And they answered and said to the king, true, O king. And then he answered, verse 25, he said, why do I see 4 men unbound walking in the midst of the fire, and they are not hurt? And the appearance of the 4th is like a son of the gods. So what is this? What is happening? 3 men go in, 4 men are in there as he looks in. They're unbound, and the 4th one looks like, he said, a son of the gods. He didn't know the son of God, Jesus himself. But clearly, this is an occurrence of when Jesus was with them in the midst of the fire. Verse 26, Nebuchadnezzar came near to the door of the burning fiery furnace. Obviously not too close because his guys just got burned up. And he declared, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, servants of the Most High God, come out and come here. Like he can tell them what to do at all, right? They're not even burning in the fire. So it's more like a suggestion at this point. Then Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego came out from the fire, and the satraps, the prefects, the governors, the king's council, they gathered together and saw that the fire had not any power over the bodies of these men. The hair of their heads was not singed, their cloaks were not harmed, no smell of the fire had come upon them. Nebuchadnezzar answered and said, "Blessed be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who has sent his angel and delivered his servants who trusted in him, and set aside the king's command and yielded up their bodies rather than serve and worship any god except for their own god. Therefore I make a decree." So here's a new law. "Any people, nation, language, or language that speaks anything against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego shall be torn limb from limb." So this guy's a pretty brutal dictator at this point. He's like, the fiery furnace, it didn't really work on these guys. Maybe it won't work on some others. Let's do a new method. Tear them limb from limb. "And their houses laid in ruins, for there is no other god who is able to rescue in this way." And then the king promoted Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the province of Babylon. So they got promoted. So their day started off pretty bad. What are we going to do? The guy set up an image. We shouldn't worship anybody but God. They didn't worship. They get thrown into the fire. And they're okay, and then they get promoted. So at the end of the day, I can just imagine them sitting around talking to each other like, "Was that this morning? Did that happen this morning?" Have you ever done that before? Was that? So it's a cool story. A couple of lessons from this fire. This could be a whole message, but we're going to go right into chapter 4 quickly. But a couple of things about this fiery trial. Number one, you're going to have a fiery trial. So this is a good illustration of what you will go through. You may not get thrown into a fiery furnace, literally, physically, but sometimes it feels like it would be better to be in a physical fiery furnace, right? Sometimes the struggles you go through and the trials. And the Bible says, don't be surprised when a fiery trial tries you, as though some strange thing is happening. It's normal for all people, and especially Christians. So we're going to have fiery trials. But what do they do? Fiery trials bring us closer to Jesus. Verse 24 and 25. He was in the fire. Where was Jesus in this whole story? He was in the fiery furnace. So if you want to be closer to Jesus, get into that fiery trial. We don't want to sign up for it, but the truth is, isn't it true that for those of you who have gone through some extreme difficult times, maybe you are now, that you feel closer to God in those times than any other time? That he becomes more real to you? Your faith becomes more genuine? That's what happens. That's a physical representation of that. Fiery trials also remove the things that bind us. It says they bound them and they threw them in. But when he looked in, Jesus was with them. And the Bible says they were unbound. The only thing that burned were the ropes that held them captive. And that's what trials do for us as well. They purify us. They remove the bondage, the things that bind us, and purify our lives for the Lord. And that's, consider it pure joy when you face trials of many kinds, because faith produces, and it talks about all the good things that happen. So it removes the things that bind us. Fiery trials will not last forever. Verse 26, it says that they came out of the fiery furnace. It wasn't like they just hung out there for the rest of their lives in Babylon. Like, where's Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? Oh, they're in the fiery furnace. I forgot. Just hanging out. They came out. They were out of the fire, and our trials don't last forever. They're temporary. And then finally, fiery trials bring a witness to those who are watching us. And it says all these different leaders, the satraps and all the rest of the guys, they saw them and they were amazed with Nebuchadnezzar that these guys weren't burned. So their trial was a witness to those who were watching. So people are watching you. You're watching me. How do we respond to the trials we go through? And the way that we respond through faith can be a witness to those who are looking in. All right, quickly, chapter 4. It's another narrative, and we'll just read through this. there's not as much application in this one. It's mostly just a dream that Nebuchadnezzar had and the interpretation. So this will be done in 10 minutes. So let's read through this. King Nebuchadnezzar, to all peoples, nations, languages that dwell on the earth, peace be multiplied to you. It has seemed good to me to show the signs and wonders that the Most High God has done for me. So Nebuchadnezzar is singing a different kind of song now. How great are his signs, how mighty are his wonders. His kingdom is an everlasting kingdom. His dominion endures from generation to generation. So this is kind of the setup, the story. Nebuchadnezzar has had a real God experience in chapter 4. In fact, something interesting, chapter 4 is one of the only chapters in the Bible that isn't written in Hebrew or Greek. Hebrew is the Old Testament, Greek is the New Testament. It's written in Aramaic. Nebuchadnezzar wrote part of the Bible. Did you know that? King Nebuchadnezzar, the guy that threw him in the fiery furnace, the guy that this is talking about, was written in his own hand. So he's writing here and he's telling his story. He says, I, Nebuchadnezzar, was at ease in my house. So you can see the video and you see the warbly lines as he's thinking back to, you know what I'm talking about? Thinking back to his story. I was prospering in my palace. I saw a dream that made me afraid. As I lay in bed, the fancies and visions of my head alarmed me. So I made a decree that all the wise men of Babylon should be brought before me. Here we go again. Remember chapter 2? Like, bring all the wise men. But this is a long time later. He's not threatening to kill him at this point. He said that they might make known to me the interpretation of the dream. Then the magicians, the enchanters, the Chaldeans, the astrologers, they came in, and I told the dream, but they could not make known to me its interpretation. At last Daniel came in before me, he who was named Belteshazzar, after the name of my God, and in whom is the spirit of the holy gods, or the holy God. So he says, I named this guy after my gods, but my gods really aren't that special. His God is the one that's special. He's the one that's able to kind of figure things out, tell me what I'm supposed to do. And I told him the dream, saying, O Belteshazzar, chief of the magicians, because I know that the spirit of the holy God is in you and that no mystery is too difficult for you, tell me the visions of my dream that I saw and their interpretation. The visions of my head as I lay in bed were these. Here's his dream. He said, I saw and behold a tree in the midst of the earth. And its height was great. The tree grew and became strong, and its top reached to heaven. It was visible to the ends of the whole earth. Its leaves were beautiful, and the fruit abundant, and in it was food for all. The beasts of the field found shade under it. The birds of the heavens lived in its branches. All flesh was fed from it. So he got the tree. He said, I saw in the vision of my head as I lay in bed, and behold, a watcher, a holy one, came down from heaven. He proclaimed aloud and said thus, chop down the tree, lop off its branches, strip off its leaves, scatter its fruit, let the beasts flee from under it and the birds from its branches, leave the stump of its roots in the earth, bound with a band of iron and bronze amid tender grass of the field, let him be wet with the dew of heaven, let his portion be with the beast in the grass of the earth, let his mind be changed from a man's, and let a beast's mind be given to him. And let 7 periods of time pass over him. That's 7 years. The sentence is by the decree of the watchers, the decision by the word of the holy ones, to the end that the living may know that the Most High rules in the kingdom of men and gives it to whom he will and sets over it the lowliest of men. That's a powerful verse, that end of verse 17. Verse 18. This dream I, King Nebuchadnezzar, saw, and you, O Belteshazzar, tell me the interpretation, because all the wise men of my kingdom are not able to make known to me the interpretation, but you are able, for the spirit of the holy gods is in you. Okay, just read a lot there. Did you get that dream? So he says, this is kind of actually a funny story, because here's the most powerful man in the world. He keeps telling people he's going to throw them in the furnace, he's going to tear their arms off, he's going to destroy their houses and their families, things like that. So it's funny because he calls in all these like professional dream interpreters, the wise men and the astrologers and the rest of the guys. And this time, because if you remember chapter 2, he didn't tell them what his dream was. He said, if you're so smart, you tell me the dream and the interpretation. This time he's like, he doesn't even mess around. He's like, I'll tell you the dream, you tell me what it means. It's funny because as you read this dream, it's kind of obvious what it means, right? Here is this tree that covers the whole world, It provides for everybody. It's over everybody. Everything in the world is under its control. It's talking about none other than Nebuchadnezzar himself. The dream was about him. So no doubt, I got to believe that Nebuchadnezzar kind of figured it out on his own, but he wanted a second opinion. It's kind of like, you get bad news, let me get a second opinion. So he calls in these guys, tell me what the dream means. Here it is. And basically describes himself, but it's a tree, not a king. And they're like, you know, that's a real tough one. I'm not sure we're going to be able to interpret that one. Sorry, king. Hope you get it figured out. So let me bring in Daniel. He knows what he's doing. And he brings in Daniel and tells him. And it says something about Daniel, though, because we're going to see in a second. He's willing to tell the guy the truth, even though it was hard to say, about the future, what God has revealed. And that should be our heart, too. Daniel's a great example of all this stuff. Verse 19. Then Daniel, whose name was Belteshazzar, was dismayed for a while. So he figured it out right away, too. He's like, oh, man. But he wasn't upset. That's not in the passage. He wasn't upset for his own well-being. He was upset because he really cared about the king. Like, he cared about this guy. He was like a friend of his at this point. So he was dismayed for a while, and his thoughts alarmed him. And the king answered and said, Belteshazzar, let not the dream or the interpretation alarm you. Belteshazzar answered, that's Daniel, answered and said, my lord, may the dream be for those who hate you and its interpretation for your enemies. The tree you saw, which grew and became strong so that its top reached heaven and it was visible to the end of the whole earth, whose leaves were beautiful, its fruit was abundant, and which food for all, under which beasts of the fields found shade and whose branches the birds of the air lived. It is you, he said, verse 22. It's you, O king, who have grown and become strong. Your greatness has grown and reaches the heaven, and your dominion to the ends of the earth. And because the king saw a watcher, a holy one, coming down from heaven and saying, chop down the tree and destroy it, but leave the stump of its roots and the earth bound with a band of iron and bronze and tender grass of the field, and let him be wet with the dew of heaven, and let his portion be with the beasts of the field, till 7 periods of time pass over him. This is the interpretation, O king. So he basically repeats the dream. He said, verse 24, it is a decree of the Most High, which has come upon my lord the king, that you shall be driven from among men, and your dwelling shall be with the beasts of the field. You shall be made to eat grass like an ox, and you shall be wet with the dew of heaven, and 7 periods of time shall pass over you. Until you know that the Most High rules the kingdom of men and gives it to whom he will. And as it was commanded to leave the stump of the roots of the tree, your kingdom shall be confirmed for you from the time that you know that heaven rules. Therefore, O king, let my counsel be acceptable to you. Break off your sins by practicing righteousness and your iniquities by showing mercy to the oppressed, that there may perhaps be a lengthening of your prosperity. I love that Daniel says this. He's basically letting him have it, the truth. And he does it with love, too. He says, man, I wish this for anybody else but you. But here's what it means. You're the king of the whole world, and what's going to happen is you're going to be cut down because God said it. But if you will repent of your sins and start doing the right thing and stop cutting people's arms and legs off and doing all this stuff you're doing and having mercy a little bit, then God will lengthen your prosperity. And that's the way God is. God always gives second chances to people. And that's what he said. So let's see what Nebuchadnezzar does. Verse 28. All this came upon King Nebuchadnezzar. At the end of 12 months, he was walking on the roof. So a year has passed. God says, he gave him a year. Let's see what he does. I know what he does. I already read it today. At the end of the 12 months, he was walking on the roof of the royal palace in Babylon. By the way, Babylon was one of the greatest civilizations in world history. One of the wonders of the world, the Hanging Gardens of Babylon, was made by Nebuchadnezzar, historical fact. So it was like the best. So he's out there on top of his royal palace. He is the leader of the best empire, world-dominating empire ever, arguably. Cyrus is another one. He's coming up later in Daniel. But here's what he says, verse 30. The king answered and said, I don't know who he's talking to, probably himself. He said, "Is not this great Babylon, which I have built by my mighty power as a royal residence and for the glory of my majesty?" So did he learn his lesson? That God is the one that... Isn't that the lesson they wanted to know? That the Most High rules in the kingdom of men. He gives it to whom he wills. Nebuchadnezzar said, "I built this. I rule this, and it's for my glory." While the words were still in the king's mouth, verse 31, there fell a voice from heaven. "O King Nebuchadnezzar, to you it is spoken, the kingdom has departed from you, and you shall be driven from among men, and your dwelling shall be with the beasts of the field, and you shall be made to eat grass like an ox, and 7 periods of time shall pass over you, until you know that the Most High rules the kingdom of men and gives it to whom he will." That's repeated 3 times in this chapter. So you think God is trying to get a point across, not only to Nebuchadnezzar, but to us today, to the president, to the emperor in China, to the world, to the European Union leaders, to everybody who holds power in this world? You don't have power. You have no power. You're just a small, insignificant, tiny person that God can easily remove and replace. That's what... So this... There's no one like Nebuchadnezzar today. No one like that. And here's what the lesson he wanted him to learn. That's why it's in the Bible, by the way, so we can learn it too. So immediately the word was fulfilled, verse 33, against Nebuchadnezzar. He was driven from among men and ate grass like an ox, and his body was wet with the dew of heaven, and his hair grew long as eagle's feathers, and his nails were like bird's claws. So this super like homeless hippie guy now living and eating grass, and just there he was. It's from Nebuchadnezzar the Great, who created one of the best empires in the world, to some dude with long hair with no clothes eating grass in the yard. Crazy. Verse 34, here's the end of the story. "At the end of days, I, Nebuchadnezzar..." So he took a little break from the personal recording. He was having a 7-year little crazy streak. But he picks up his pen again. "At the end of days, I, Nebuchadnezzar, lifted my eyes to heaven, and my reason returned to me. I lifted my eyes to heaven, and my..." This is the way it is. You recognize God, you acknowledge God's place in life, and that's when you really start figuring things out. And he said, "And I blessed the Most High and praised and honored him who lives forever. For his dominion is an everlasting dominion. His kingdom endures from generation to generation. All the inhabitants of the earth are accounted as nothing. He does according to his will among the hosts of heaven and among the inhabitants of earth. And none can stay his hand or say to him, 'What have you done?' At the same time, my reason returned to me, and for the glory of my kingdom, my majesty and my splendor returned to me. My counselors and my lords sought me, and I was established in my kingdom, and still more greatness was added to me. Now I, Nebuchadnezzar, praise and extol and honor the King of heaven, for all his works are right and his ways are just." And he ends with a very powerful statement. He says, "And those who walk in pride, he is able to humble." This is a great story. He learned his lesson at the end. Took him 7 years of being a crazy dude walking around in the yard. I think it's funny how it says his lords and counselors sought him, like, "Oh, you're back. Like, are you okay?" Because no doubt they saw him out there. They were kind of taking care of him, making sure he didn't die or whatever, because that's the king. And they were kind of overseeing affairs. And God gave him the kingdom back because he learned his lesson. He learned that God humbles the proud but exalts the humble. And the same principle is true today. In our little sphere of life, we start to get proud and think that we're something special, or we're the important one, or we're making it happen. It's not us. It's God who's allowing these things to happen. He's in control. And that's good, a good lesson to learn, that he's able to humble the proud and that he's in control of the affairs of men. So, Daniel chapter 3 and chapter 4. Woo! Good stuff. Let's pray. Lord, thank you again for your word. Help us to be like Daniel, like Shadrach, like Meshach, and like Abednego. And even like Nebuchadnezzar at the end, where at the very end of his life and his reign in his kingdom, recognize that you are the one that life is all about. You are the one in control. You are the one that's worthy of our praise. And just like the psalmist says, what is man that you are mindful of him? And we're seemingly so insignificant in the grand scheme of things. But you love us and you care about us, and we're thankful for that. Bless everyone as they leave tonight, and give them a great rest of the week. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.